Okay, guys, do not forget to like, share, subscribe. One thing that has been really surprising as I've studied these various people that we've been looking at this year is that a lot of their experiences and even little moments in the way their lives unfold really still point to the end times, really still points to the coming kingdom. And that was something that we covered all throughout 2020. But it's just really, really been interesting to see how that all weaves together.
Keep in mind that Isaac was a young adult, was not just a young boy who would not understand what is he actually going through. And he obeyed. He carried the firewood and went up the mountain with his father, asking about where's the sheep. And when his father just told him, God will provide, he probably understood the situation that he's been in. And what makes us understand that is what comes later here in this passage. So the two of them went together. They came to the place where God had told him. And Abraham built an altar there and placed the firewood in order. And he bound Isaac, his son, hand and foot, and laid him on the altar upon the firewood. See, he's always repeating that firewood part. And you see here that he bound Isaac, his son, hand and foot. And that's exactly what happened to our Lord Jesus Christ on the cross. He went on the cross with his own will, obeyed his Father for our sake, for our salvation. And he carried the cross along the way to reach the top of the Golgotha, the same as Isaac went up the Mount of Moriah to be sacrificed. And he was tied on the firewood, the same as our Lord Jesus Christ was nailed to the cross to be lifted up on the cross.
So kind of as a recap, Abuna, Isaac represents our Lord Jesus Christ, and Abraham represents the Father. Isaac is very similar to what would happen to our Lord Jesus Christ. He carried the wood up the hill. He was also born miraculously, right, just as the Lord Jesus Christ was born to a virgin. And he was the only son of the Father, just as the Lord Jesus
Christ's only beloved son.
That's amazing.
As we see here, then Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. So he said, Here I am. He then replied, Do not lay your hand on the lad or do anything to him. For now I know you fear God. And Abraham lifted his eyes and looked, and there behind him a ram was caught in a thicket by its horns. And this was the actual sacrifice, the lamb, the Lamb of God. So we see here obedience. It's a very strong word that we can see it in Isaac, that he obeyed his father, knowing that he's going to die. And the same for our Lord Jesus Christ. He obeyed the Father, knowing that he's going to die for the whole world. And this was out of love and out of faith of Abraham, knowing that God, even he promised him that out of his seed there will be many to come the same, the Lord Jesus Christ, out of his seed, out of his death on the cross, we were all born to him and became a multiplied people who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and his blood to forgive our sin.
Then I saw another angel who had the seal of the living God rise up from the east. He cried out in a loud voice to the four angels who were empowered to harm the earth and the sea, Don't harm the earth or the sea or the trees until we seal the slaves of our God on their foreheads. And I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 sealed from every tribe of the Israelites, 12,000 sealed from the tribe of Judah, 12,000 from the tribe of Reuben, 12,000 from the tribe of Gad, 12,000 from the tribe of Asher, 12,000 from the tribe of Naphtali, 12,000 from the tribe of Manasseh, 12,000 from the tribe of Simeon, 12,000 from the tribe of Levi, 12,000 from the tribe of Issachar, 12,000 from the tribe of Zebulun, 12,000 from the tribe of Joseph, 12,000 sealed from the tribe of Benjamin. After this, I looked, and there was a vast multitude from every nation, tribe, people, and language which no one could number, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were robed in white with palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb."
If you think that it is true that we all have to go through tribulation, and people always say, well, why would the saints back in the day go through tribulation, and we don't have to? You have to understand, Jesus Christ wants us to have our name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And if your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you are not appointed to wrath. Those who do not have their names written in the Lamb's Book of Life will go through tribulation. If it were so that all had to go through tribulation, let's go to the context of the days of Noah and today. During the days of Noah and during the time of the coming of the Son of Man, it will be the same. Look around you. Is it the same as the days of Noah? Yes, it is. There was genetic modifications going on in the days of Noah. That are going on right now. You had Nephilim, giants walking around. You have Nephilim DNA wielding individuals walking around right now. They may not be giant, not all of them, but you have Nephilim DNA wielding individuals walking around right now that are not human. There was total iniquity going on in that time. Look at today, iniquity abounding, the love of many growing cold. We will not be appointed to wrath. And people always say, well, wrath is the last 3.5 years. We aren't even appointed to the tribulation at all. We are brought up above the flood waters before the flood even starts. Noah was brought into the ark before the flood started. 7 days prior, he was brought into the ark. Hallelujah. 7 days prior is a correlation to the 7 years. Was a correlation to we being taken up 7 years prior to the flood. All know that we would not be flooded again because the Lord Jesus Christ gave us a covenant with the rainbow showing us that we would not be flooded again. But Noah going into the ark 7 days prior was a correlation to us being taken 7 years prior to the flood, to the great tribulation, to tribulation period.
Job chapter 24. Why does the Almighty not reserve times for judgment? Why do those who know him never see his days? 1 Peter chapter 4. Friends, don't be surprised when the fiery ordeal comes among you to test you, as if something unusual were happening to you. Instead, rejoice as you share in the sufferings of the Messiah, so that you may also rejoice with great joy at the revelation of his glory. If you are ridiculed for the name of Christ, you are blessed because the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. None of you, however, should suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or a meddler. But if anyone suffers as a Christian, he should not be ashamed, but should glorify God in having that name. For the time has come for judgment to begin with God's household. And if it begins with us, What will the outcome be for those who disobey the gospel of God? James chapter 5. Therefore, brothers, be patient until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth and is patient with it until it receives the early and the late rains? You also must be patient. Strengthen your hearts, because the Lord's coming is near. Brothers, do not complain about one another, so that you will not be judged. Look, the judge stands at the door. Brothers, take the prophets who spoke in the Lord's name as an example of suffering and patience. See, we count as blessed those who have endured. You have heard of Job's endurance and have seen the outcome from the Lord. The Lord is very compassionate and merciful. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, yet he prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the land. Then he prayed again, and the sky gave rain, and the land produced its fruit. Ezekiel chapter 14. The word of the Lord came to me, Son of man, if a land sins against me by acting faithlessly, and I stretch out my hand against it to cut off its supply of bread, to send famine through it, and to wipe out both man and animal from it, even if these three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, were in it, they would deliver only themselves by their righteousness. This is the declaration of the Lord God. If I allow dangerous animals to pass through the land and depopulate it, so that it becomes desolate, with no one passing through it for fear of the animals, even if these three men were in it, as I live, the declaration of the Lord God, they could not deliver their sons or daughters. They alone would be delivered, but the land would be desolate. Or if I bring a sword against that land, and say, Let a sword pass through it, so that I wipe out both man and animal from it, even if these three men were in it, as I live, the declaration of the Lord God, they could not deliver their sons or daughters, but they alone would be delivered. Or if I send a plague into that land, and pour out my wrath on it with bloodshed, to wipe out both man and animal from it, even if Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it, as I live, the declaration of the Lord God, they could not deliver their son or daughter. They would deliver only themselves by their righteousness. For this is what the Lord God says, How much worse will it be when I send my 4 devastating judgments against Jerusalem, sword, famine, dangerous animals, and plague, in order to wipe out both man and animal from it? Even so, there will be survivors left in it, sons and daughters who will be brought out. Indeed, they will come out to you, and you will observe their conduct and actions. Then you will be consoled about the devastation I have brought on Jerusalem, about all I have brought on it. They will bring you consolation when you see their conduct and actions, and you will know that it was not without cause that I have done what I did to it. This is the declaration of the Lord God. Revelation chapter 20. Then I saw a great white throne, and one seated on it. Earth and heaven fled from his presence, and no place was found for them. I also saw the dead, the great and the small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged according to their works by what was written in the books. Then the sea gave up its dead, and death and Hades gave up their dead. All were judged according to their works.
The one other thing that I want to add about Elijah is his story doesn't end where the story ends in the Old Testament. We see him mentioned throughout the New Testament. Other references, even Jesus on the mountain when he was talking with Moses and Elijah. There's no definitive name mentioned for who the two witnesses in Revelation 11 are. 99% likely that those are Moses and Elijah.
Instead of selling a message of hope in exchange for obedience, they'll deliver a message of condemnation and claim to be testifying on behalf of the one true God. Revelation calls them the two witnesses. Will people believe their message? Instead of giving false hope, they will clearly expose the sins of humanity and its leaders. by divine authority and command, they will act with power against those who oppose them. They'll bring drought on the nations who reject their message. Deadly punishment will be brought down on those who try to harm them. Their warning message will testify to the people of the world of impending doom unless they listen, repent, and change their actions. Two sets of powerful men, both claiming authority. Faced with this dilemma, who will the world choose to follow? Who would you follow?
So what I want to do first is just read the passage about the two witnesses. So let's go to Revelation chapter 11 and begin reading in verse 3. There's only two people in the Old Testament that these witnesses could be. I don't want to give my opinion today. I just want to give scripture.
There are these two witnesses who are given a voice to prophesy in these very difficult days, and hell comes against them, but they keep speaking. We're told one of these two has power to shut up the heavens so there'll be no rain, and the other has power over waters to turn them into blood, etc. This reminds me of the days of Elijah and the days of Moses, and some think these witnesses are akin to those personalities.
And here, verse 7, it says, when they shall have finished their testimony, the beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them and shall overcome them and kill them. Verse 8, and their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom in Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. And they of the people and kindreds and tongues and nations shall see their dead bodies 3 days and a half, and shall not suffer their dead bodies to be put in graves. And they that dwell upon the earth shall rejoice over them and make merry and send gifts one to another, because these two prophets tormented them that dwelt on the earth. And after 3 days and a half, the spirit of life from God entered into them, and they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell upon them which saw them. Yeah, I bet. In verse 12 even says, and they heard a great voice from heaven saying unto them, come up hither. And they ascended up to heaven in a cloud, and their enemies beheld them. So this is what the Bible says will happen with these two witnesses. So these two witnesses have power. And the power of these two witnesses is to shut up heaven in the context of rain, so that it doesn't rain. And their other power is to turn water to blood. With that power of turning water to blood, they have the power to do plagues. Aside from the fact that they have the power to blow fire out of their mouths to devour their enemies, which is kind of interesting. So, does that sound like some people that you've heard of in the Old Testament? Is there anyone in the Old Testament that had power to turn water into blood? Was there anyone in the Old Testament that had power to keep it from raining? 1 Kings 17 and verse 1, and Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. So Elijah says, God told me to tell you, it's not going to rain for years until I say so. And look at this in James chapter 5 and verse 17. Elias, which is another way of saying Elijah. Elias was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. 3.5 years! Well, that's exactly how long this witness is going to be doing that in the future. So it sounds like Elijah is tied in to the witness here. They may just be one and the same.
Both of them become the object of demonic wrath, and they're executed only to rise again. Breath enters into them again in verse 11, and they stand up, and this creates quite a stir. The point is, things get dark, true, but the light is about to shine. The kingdom of this world, in verse 15, is going to be the kingdom of our Lord and of his anointed one, and he shall reign forever and ever.
That's all I've got for you guys today. Don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and I will see you guys a little bit later. Bye, guys.